What's up, you crew? This is Dustin Stelzer with Electrician U, and today we are going to install a surge protector. So there are two different styles of surge protectors that go in electrical panels. One is going to be the plug-on neutral style that you just snap in place. The other is going to be one that has leads on it. And typically only type 1 and type 2 surge protectors are going to be put into panels. Anything that's a type 3 or type 4 is inside of a home or a building. If you want to know a little bit more about the whole type 1, type 2, type 3, type 4 thing, click here. I have a video I just did that goes over surge protectors in quite some length. But today we're going to be showing two different styles. So the first style is the plug-on neutral style. There's no leads on it. You just snap this into your electrical panel on one of the buses. It takes up two slots, just like a two-pole breaker would. The great thing about this is that there is no leads. It just snaps right in. You don't have all of these conductors that you have to cut and strip out, and you don't have to put, you know, a breaker in and do all of that stuff. You just snap this thing in place and you're good to go. It has its own integral overcurrent protection, which means it's a type 1 surge protector. A type 2 surge protector has to be protected by a breaker. So there are also type 1s that have leads and type 1s that don't. The second style that we're going to be putting in today actually is a type 1 that has leads. It's the HEP D from Square D. It's not a snap-in style. It does have leads, but it's still a type 1 surge protector because it has its own overcurrent protection on the inside of it. But you still can install this on a breaker. So let's get to it. Today we're going to install the HEP D80 in my panel. First thing that we need to do is put in a new breaker. I'm not going to tap this on the line side of my main breaker like it says that you can. That's just silly. So what I'm going to do is install a new 2-pole 20. That is a breaker that takes up two slots in a panel because it's on two different phases. That's what is often called a 220 breaker, but it's a 20 amp breaker that takes up two slots in a panel. Now that I've got the breaker in, I need to knock out a hole in the bottom side of my service panel. A half inch hole is all that I need to knock out. Be careful not to knock out any more than that, or else you're going to have to use some kind of reducing washer or something to fill that hole. And we're talking about a waterproof environment, so you don't want to like overdo holes. You want to keep everything as tight as possible. Now that I've got my hole knocked out, I'm going to feed my leads in and feed the device in and put the lock ring back on it. Make sure that the lock ring is tight. Use your screwdriver and your lineman's pliers to hit that lock ring on and get it a little bit tighter. Now that I've got the leads in, I need to think about lead length. Lead length is an important thing to consider because the longer the leads are, the less effective the surge protector is going to be. There's this thing called let through voltage that is basically when a surge happens, still a little bit of voltage from that surge is going to get to your equipment. But the amount of it is what the let through voltage is all about. So the longer that your leads are, the more of that surge is going to get into your equipment. The shorter the leads are, the better, which is why the whole plug-on neutral thing is great, because there's no leads at all. So it's pretty close to 100% effective. Anything that you have leads, the longer that you go, the more, basically each foot that you add adds 160 volts of let through voltage. So you can see quite quickly, the longer the length of those leads, the less effective that the device is going to be. So I would try to get these leads as short as possible. There's nothing wrong with putting the breaker all the way at the bottom or all the way at the top. Put the breaker wherever it needs to be to make sure that your lead length as little as possible. First thing that I terminate is the ground. This device is metal, so it does have an equipment grounding conductor on it. So I'm going to connect that first. Next wire that I hook up is the grounded conductor, or the neutral. And the last thing I hook up are the ungrounded phase conductors, or what we call the HOTs. Both of them go to the 2-pole breaker. Once I've got all of those terminations tightened down to manufacturer's torque settings, it's time to turn the breaker on. I flip my breaker on, pull out my multimeter, and actually test the voltage that's coming out of the breaker. And anytime that I test voltage, I always make sure that I test from all of the various things to all of the various things. And what I mean by that is I don't just test between line one and line two coming off the breaker to make sure I have 240 volts coming off. A lot of people will do this and they won't go any further. Anytime you have your multimeter out and you're testing, test everything. I mean, you need to know fully that everything is good, not just that those two screws are good. So what I do is I take from L1 with one of my leads and I go to ground, make sure that I've got 120 volts to ground. Then I go from L1 to neutral and make sure I have 120 volts to neutral. And I do the same thing for L2 to ground, L2 to neutral, and then I go L1 to L2. This is making sure that you have the correct voltages between all of the correct things. And I even go as far as to go between neutral and ground to make sure that I have 0 volts. I don't want a difference of potential from my neutral to my ground. I want to make sure that that says 0. So I've checked all of the different variables. Everything's good to go. I know I have a good 220 volts going to this piece of equipment. I know that it's installed with the right lead lengths, short as possible. And I've read through the warranty manual just to make sure that the installation that I've done is to the manufacturer's specs, so that if something does happen or go wrong, I make sure that the warranty protects everything. Now, let's talk about the warranties a little bit. With surge protection devices, these companies are warrantying that their stuff is going to work against these transient surges from utilities, from lightning, or from, you know, the equipment in your home. So it's really important that they have solid warranties, and most of them do. You just have to fully understand what is being warrantied. So when you buy one of these devices, whether it's a type 3, type 1, type 2, they're all gonna have a set kind of manufacturer warranty. Some of them is gonna be like a year warranty on some of the cheaper ones. Some of them will be like a 5-year manufacturer warranty. A manufacturer warranty for everything, all that means is if their equipment stops working, then you can take it back, they'll replace it for you. That's not saying if lightning happens or if a surge happens, that's just saying the piece of equipment itself, if it ends up being faulty or something's wrong with it, you can go swap it out. The other warranty is called a connected equipment warranty. So that means anything that's connected to this, in the event a surge happens, if this piece of equipment, if this, like, you know, plug strip surge protector, or if the surge protector out there fails and it doesn't do its job and it was installed correctly, if it fails to do its job, there's a warranty that protects all of the equipment up to a certain dollar amount. So some of these, it's like $400,000. Some of them, it's like $50,000, $100,000, just kind of depends. But that means if a surge happens and this thing didn't do its job and all your shit gets destroyed, they will replace up to that dollar amount worth of stuff. So you need to, on any of these surge protectors as an electrician, you need to know the warranties of the products that you're recommending to people and which ones are better and worse. And you need to tell the homeowners about all of this stuff, because you don't want it coming back on you, because it's going to. You're the one that's going to get the call about all the exploded equipment and everything. But you need to be educated about it as well, because it protects you knowing the warranty information. So just know if there's a faulty problem, you have two different kinds of warranties, but also make sure that you read every single letter and word in these warranty agreements, because there's a lot of legalese and a lot of wording that you may not understand unless you sit and kind of comb through it all. But instructions are really, really important in anything nowadays that's coming from a manufacturer that you're taking the liability to install. You have to know the code, but you need to start reading instructions and really, really understanding that you're, whether or not you're doing this right. There's a lot of like arc fault breakers and stuff out there too, that you're only gonna know, specifically with Square D, that when one of the arc fault breakers or DF breakers or ground fault breakers trips, if it trips fast, it means something. If it trips slow over a certain amount of time, that means something else. There's diagnostics that are engineered with this piece of equipment, that's telling you stuff. But the only way you're gonna know that is if you read the instructions. So I know that the electricians don't like to read instructions. We're just like, I know what I'm doing, I'm just gonna get in here and boom. I get it, but when you're talking about warrantying things and houses burning down and not arcing and not killing people and all of that, you need to really read the instructions. Make sure that you and the homeowners that you are selling this stuff to are reading the instructions and they know what the warranties cover. It's very important. So that was pretty painless, right? Installing surge protectors is pretty easy. The hardest part is just knowing what they do, knowing the warranties, knowing how to install them properly, and being aware of what they do in the first place. And that's, again, why I would watch that video that I did earlier on surge protectors, just so if you're sitting there talking to a customer as an electrician, you know what you're talking about and you know what a surge protector does, what it doesn't, what it is, what it isn't, what you're actually protecting against, what the warranties are all about. I think it's really important because there's tons of misinformation out there. So let me know if you guys have any other questions. Appreciate all your attention and I will see you in the next one.